Then we started looking at dictionary compression. We first calculated the amount of space that is going to be taken by the dictionary on the RCV1 corpus without compression. So that was our base calculation, and it turned out that the size of the dictionary without compression was about 11.2 megabytes, and we were then trying to incrementally add more and more compression techniques to cut down this size. The first thing that we did was we stored, instead of storing each term in this table, allocating 20 bytes for each term, instead of doing that, we maintained this global dictionary, a global string, this huge string, which was basically a concatenation of all the dictionary terms in alphabetical order. And why did we do that? Because each term on an average was only 8 bytes long, whereas we had allocated 20 bytes earlier in the naive uncompressed solution. So if we maintain this whole, this entire string, which is basically all the strings, all the terms in the dictionary concatenated, then on an average each term is taking up 8 bytes. So we ended up saving a significant amount of space, although we had to also allocate space for these pointers, which were pointing to the first letter of every string, every respective string. So instead of storing the term here, we had a pointer pointing to the location of that term in this global string. And we saw that this kind of a solution ends up cutting down the size of the dictionary from about 11.2 megabytes to about 7.6 megabytes without affecting the performance in terms of the speed with which we can answer a query or look up a term in the dictionary. Right? Given a query, if we want to look up a particular term in the dictionary, we can still do it using this technique. We can still do the binary search in order to quickly hone down in order log n time, where n is the number of terms in the dictionary. We can quickly hone down what the pointer to the what the location of the that particular query term is, which will then give us the pointer to the postings list for that term. So we can follow this pointer to the disk and then retrieve the postings list for that term. And then we added, then we tried to save even more space by saying that instead of maintaining all these pointers, instead of maintaining pointers for every term, let us maintain pointers for every fourth term. Okay, so let's group together terms in blocks of four, and let's have a single pointer from a block, maybe a pointer from the first term of each block. So that means we ended up saving space on these three. So if this is a block of four terms, we ended up saving space on the pointers for these three terms. So instead of doing binary search on every term here, we'll have to do, given a query term, we'll need to search for that term using binary search only on locations where, from where there is a pointer. Okay, so the number of pointers went down by a factor of four. So we had about 1/4 as many pointers that we had before. And the way we were maintaining these four terms in this string was not by just concatenating them, because we also need to keep track of the boundaries between successive terms. And so we allocated one byte that would tell us the length of this the string that is following that byte. Okay, so every string is maintained as a single byte, which contains the length of the string, which is also the number of characters in that string. So this 7 tells us that the next 7 characters are going to be the term. And then the byte after that will tell us what the number of characters in the next string are. So in this way, when we look up this term pointer, we can do a scan, a linear scan of these four strings to figure out what these four strings are. And we know where the next block ends because, I mean, firstly, the byte after the very last byte of this string will be the beginning of the next block. But we can also say that the next pointer would be pointing to the location at the beginning of the block. So this should actually point over here. So when we do binary search, we may have to not just look up what this string is as we were doing before. All we needed to do here was to just look up, read this string. Now we have to look up the lengths also, and also we have to read all the four strings if necessary. So it costs us a little in terms of the time. We need to spend more time now doing this linear scan. And in fact, we saw that even though we could achieve better compression by maintaining as few pointers here as possible. So instead of grouping together four terms at a time, if we group together 8 terms at a time or 16 terms at a time or 32 terms at a time, we would cut down the number of pointers to 1/8 of the original number or 1/16 of the original number and so on. But then these blocks, individual blocks, would have 16 strings or 32 strings, which means we'll need to do a lot more processing of these strings within each block when we do this lookup operation. And so there's a trade-off here. Even though we are achieving better compression, it's costing us more in terms of time. And so we can't just keep on increasing the value of k without being hit on the in terms of the time.
Excuse
so
me.
Any questions? Yeah, any questions so far?
In that blocking previous slide,
yeah,
there was a number digit which denotes number of characters after that. So is that only characters or will there be any digits also included?
Sorry, I didn't get. Are you asking about these?
Yeah.
These values?
So if the digit is 7, so next 7, will it be only characters or digits can also be included, numbers also?
So that depends on the encoding. Okay, so if you have the ASCII character set, for example, okay, let's say that these strings are represented in ASCII. So ASCII character sets can incorporate numbers as well as, you know, simple text in English. So ASCII characters are 7-bit long, but actually they take up 1 byte because the first bit is 0 and the next seven bits of the byte are used to represent the actual character. So if this is an ASCII string, then this would represent the length of the string. Okay, so for example, this 7 would indicate that the next 7 bytes stand for one single string. Okay, so this S would take up 1 byte, this Y would take up 1 byte, this S would take up 1 byte, this T would take up 1 byte, and so on. So it's the length of the string, which is also the number of bytes being taken by the string, because in ASCII encoding, each character is represented by 1 byte, whether it's an alphabetical character or whether it is a numeric character.
Sir, excuse me.
Yeah.
Sir, that question, I would like to extend that question. Within the string, suppose if we get the numbers, like 7 is the length of the string. So within the string, suppose if it is an alphanumeric type of thing where we encounter a number within that. So I hope that's what he was asking about.
Yeah, so when you follow the pointer, you have to interpret this byte as a number. Okay, but the next 7 bytes have to be interpreted as ASCII characters. Okay? So some of those characters may denote digits, numerical digits. Some of them may denote alphabetical characters. But you're not going to interpret these as integers, because okay, this 7 is telling you that the next 7 are actually the characters of the string. And those characters can be, you know, numerical characters also, but they are part of the string. They are not to be interpreted as, you know, numerical values. After these 7 bytes, the 8th byte, that is the byte that you will next interpret as an integer and as denoting the length of the string that is following this byte. So I hope that's clear.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So by doing that, we end up saving some more space. We ended up at least with k equal to 4. We ended up saving 0.5 megabytes more. Okay. So note that we've done 2 things here. We first represented all the terms by this global string. So that was the that achieved the first level of compression. And then we are further.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, you said the number, the string will be starting with a number, right?
The string will be starting with a number denoting number. The length of the string. Yeah.
Okay. So what if the number is a 2-digit number, or?
So here we are assuming that the number is going to be represented as a single byte. That means the maximum possible length of a string is going to be 255, which is the largest number that can be represented in a single byte. Right, so we have to precisely fix the format. Okay, if we say it's going to be 1 byte, it has to be 1 byte all over. If we say it's going to be 2 bytes, it needs to be 2 bytes everywhere, so that the interpretation of this entire string is unambiguous. Okay, after all, this whole string is going to be represented ultimately as a sequence of bits in memory. So we have to know how to interpret that sequence of bits in a very, very precise way. So we have to fix the format very, very carefully. And we are saying here that the format is going to be that the first byte is going to indicate the length of the string that follows. And then whatever that length is, we'll need to read the next several bytes corresponding to that length as the string. So if we are fixing 1 byte here as the length, that means we cannot have 2 bytes. That means each string is constrained to be of a maximum length of 255.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so the second level of compression was achieved by blocking up these terms into chunks of 4 each. Now, just to drive home the point that on an average you'll be spending more time searching for strings, here is a comparison of what would happen if we did not, you know, what would be the effect on the computation time, as a result of this compression. Note that whenever you're compressing data, it's going to take you some extra time to decompress it. But on the other hand, you're saving space. So that's your goal. So this extra computation time may be tolerable, but it shouldn't increase too much. So just to show that it is going to increase, here's a comparison of what would happen with and without this compression. That is, if we don't compress the dictionary in this particular way, that is, let's say we just go with this particular representation, what would have been the average time taken for us to retrieve the pointer to the postings list for a given a particular term? Okay, given a term, how much time does it take to retrieve the pointer to the postings list? Let's calculate that. So let's assume that our dictionary has 8 terms, okay? And these 8 terms are obviously stored as an array of size 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, okay? And in alphabetic lexicographic order. So job is the middle term. Den is the middle term in the upper half. Actually, job will probably come here. And then in the upper half, which has four terms, den will be here. And then ex will be here below den, and box and aid will be above den. And below job you have pit, above pit you have ox, and below pit you have win. So given a term, you're going to do binary search, right? So this is going to be the middle element of your array, and you'll start from this middle element. If your query term is less than the middle element, then you're going to search in the upper half of the array. And if your query term is larger than the middle element, then you're going to search in the lower half of the array. Okay. Now, if you go to the upper half, then you'll again look at the middle term in the upper half, which is den. Okay, that's what this is indicating. And then you'll compare your query term to den. If your query term is less than den, then you're going to search in the upper half. Otherwise, you're going to search in the lower half. So you see how this tree representation is actually the sequence of binary search moves, right? So this, so the very first thing that you're going to do when you do binary search is you're going to look up this term, which is job. And based on the outcome of the of the comparison, you'll either move here or here. Now let's assume something. Let's assume something simple. Let's assume that all these eight terms are equally likely to be in the query. Okay, that means on an average, we will search for job as many number of times as we will search for den, as many number of times as we'll search for box, and so on. Okay, so assuming each dictionary term is equally likely in the query, what will be the average number of steps we will take to reach the term that we are searching for? If we were searching for job or job, we would, you know, depending on whether you interpret this as a name or as the English letter job, depending on, so if you're searching for job, how many operations would we take? One operation, right?
One operation.
Yeah. If we were searching for den, then we would take two operations, because we would first look at job and then we would find that our query term is less than this one, and then we would go to den. So there would be two operations. Similarly, searching for pit would take two operations. Searching for any of these four terms would take three operations. And searching for aid would take four operations. So the average number of operations we'll be doing will be the average of all these values. Okay. And that average turns out to be about 2.6. Now, here's a question for you. We assumed here that all the terms are equally likely to occur in the query. What if they weren't? Let's say den was more likely to occur than pit, or x was more likely to occur than job. How would you structure your dictionary so that you minimize the average number of operations? Okay, so this is something to think about. Basically, you will take the terms that are most likely to occur and keep them as close to the root as possible. Okay, and the terms that are least likely to occur will be kept far away, because even though those terms will take more number of operations, they are still rare. They're rare enough that we can afford spending more time on those terms. We cannot afford spending too much time on terms that are very frequent. So those terms should be kept as close as possible to the root. Okay, but right now let's go with this simple assumption that all terms are equally likely, in that case this is the average number of operations we'll be doing. So this is the average number of operations we will take if we don't compress the dictionary. And actually this applies both to the uncompressed version and also to this version. Okay, after the first kind of compression we did, after we stored the entire sequence of terms as a global string, we'll still take the same number of operations because we'll be doing binary search just like before, except that we'll be following these term pointers in addition to doing the binary search. Instead of finding the terms directly stored here, we'll be looking them up in this global string. Now see what happens. Let's see what happens when we block together these terms, say 4 at a time. Okay. So let's look at what happens when k is equal to 4. In that case, these 4 terms will be chunked together and these 4 terms will be chunked together. So we will have in our table, we'll have only, well, we will have 8 rows, but only two of those rows will have pointers. These will be term pointers and they will be pointing to locations within this string. And this location is going to be, okay, the string starts here, let's say. So this will be the string aid followed by box followed by den followed by x. And this string will be job followed by ox followed by pit followed by win. So when we search for job, we will again take only a single operation because, you know, we'll just look up this term pointer and we'll find job over here. But if we are searching for ox, okay, note that this is going to be stored as 3 job, 2 ox, 3 pit, and 3 win. And the first string is going to be stored as 3 aid, 3 box, 3 den, and 2x. And the whole string will be this concatenated with this. So searching for job will take less time because we can just have a single operation. And then we'll look up the term pointer and we'll find job at the beginning. But if you're searching for pit, we'll take 2 operations because we will again follow this term pointer. Okay, from job, we'll conclude that this is the pointer we need to follow because there is no string after this. Okay, and pit is definitely after job. So because there is no pointer after this and this is pointing to job, we're going to start searching linearly in this string, searching for pit. So we will find pit over here. Okay, so we have to do 2 more operations. We have to search, look at the next string and then look at the next string. And then we'll find pit. To search for win, we will need to do 4 operations. Okay, once to reach here, then we'll have to interpret this string, we'll have to interpret this string, and then we'll have to interpret this string. Right, so this is what it will look like. If our binary search will make us start from here, and if our query term ends up being less than this, then we will look at the other term pointer. And if our query term is greater than the other term pointer, then we'll have to linearly scan this list. Likewise, if our query term is greater than this term, then we'll have to linearly scan through the block for that term. So this will take 1 operation. This will take 2 operations. This will take 1 more operation, 3. This will take 1 more, 4. This will take 1 more, 5. Because all these are linearly placed after, you know, along a single string. And so it takes more time to reach x now because we have to examine all the three strings before it, before we can reach here. So this will take 1, 2, 3 and 4. So the average now is going to be 1 plus twice of 2 plus twice of 3 plus twice of 4 plus 5 divided by the total number of terms, which is 8. And that turns out to be 3. And 3 is more than 2.6. So you can see that we've done a rigorous calculation here to show that the average number of operations we'll be doing for each term is going to be more. So this is going to take more time, even though we have better compression. We're saving on space, but we are sacrificing on time. Any questions on this? You can do similar calculations for k equal to 8, and you're going to find that the difference will be more, even more, between the compressed case and the uncompressed case. So you can try that as an exercise. We've already done this for k equal to 4. You can try to compute what the slowdown is going to be when the block size is made 8 or 16. Any questions on this? And if you are more interested in the details of, so we're not going to cover what exactly we do here, but there is something called Huffman codes. You can look up what Huffman codes are. And that's related to this exercise. Okay, the Huffman codes are basically they correspond to the structuring of a particular dictionary, so that such that if when you know the frequencies with which different terms are going to be accessed, you can actually structure your dictionary or your search tree so that it will you will end up minimizing the total number of operations. Here, of course, we're not literally storing it as a tree, we are storing it as an array, but then you can conceptually think of this as a tree, because we'll be accessing the array in this particular way. So we are going to do one more additional level of compression over and above what we've already done. And that is based on a simple observation that when you have a set of terms that are alphabetically ordered, many times you're going to find that if you look at consecutive terms, they will share a long prefix. For example, in the dictionary, you may find the term automata, and the term automate may immediately follow it. Okay, so this is the lexicographic order in the dictionary. And then you have automatic, and then you have automation. And let's imagine that these four are located in the same block. So we are taking the solution that we've developed so far and then doing something more. So imagine these four stored in the same block. So we are again looking at k equal to 4. So in the previous solution, how would automata be stored? This is how it would be stored. 8 automata, 8 automate, 9 automatic, 10 automation. 8, 8, 9 and 10 are the lengths of these four strings. That's how we would store them. But if we exploit the fact that all of these four strings share a common prefix, we can separate out the common prefix and only write down the differences following that prefix in the four terms. So AUTOMAT is the common prefix between all four of these terms. And so let's write down this common prefix first. This special wildcard character indicates the end of the common prefix. And what follows this is just going to be the difference, the section of the string that is different across these four words. So the first word has A after the common prefix. So we'll write this A and the string ends here. Then we write a 1, because what we are doing here is we are only storing the section of the string that follows the common prefix, and that has a length of just 1. Why? Because the second string is automate and E is the only character that follows this common prefix. Similarly, having already assumed automat, going for automatic means we just have to store I and C. So the next string will be of length 2 and the next string will be of length 3. Okay, so this is the extra length beyond the common prefix, these three values. And we have this diamond shape here to indicate that this is a special character indicating that the string that follows of length 1 or 2 or 3 is not an entire string. It is only the suffix. It is the extra length beyond the common prefix. So to get the actual string, we have to take the common prefix, which is up to the wildcard, and then concatenate it with the extra length. Okay, so this is what we'll do. So this is called front coding, because we are taking the front of a string, storing it as a common prefix, and then storing whatever is different in the four strings separately. So by that we are going to end up saving more space. Instead of having this long string, we'll just have this shorter string. Now clearly it's difficult to estimate what will be the, I mean, we can see that we're going to compress the global string by employing front coding, but it's going to be difficult for us to precisely estimate what will be the actual savings in terms of space, because that is going to depend on the dictionary of the index. Okay, we can't do this kind of calculation. It's kind of mathematical calculation to prove what will be, how much space we will save. So this has been done empirically on the RCV corpus. And it turns out that we can go down from 7.1 megabytes to 5.9 megabytes by adding front coding. So this was what we started with, without compression. By going for a dictionary as a string method, with pointers to every term in the string, we went down to 7.6. Then by adding blocking, we went down to 7.1. And now by adding front coding, it turns out that the original dictionary now takes up only 5.9 megabytes. So you can see that we've saved half of the space. We are able to compress it to half of the size. And notice that given a term, looking up that term in the dictionary is not going to take, it's going to take a reasonable amount of time. It's going to take more time than what it was taking before, but it's not going to be a whole lot more. Okay, you can still think of a simple algorithm that will continue looking up a term in the dictionary following binary search, but then it will have to also decompress this string into the original terms and then, you know, be able to read the original terms to go about doing that binary search. And I hope you can all see that that's not going to take much time. So recall that this is an example of lossless compression, because we're not losing any information in compressing the dictionary from the uncompressed version to any of these three or four compressed versions. All terms can be retrieved as they are. We haven't lost any information. Unlike lossy compression, which is the kind of compression usually employed in video and audio files. But you can also think of stemming and the other kinds of normalization we were doing as forms of lossy compression. So this finishes with the third section of this chapter, which is dictionary compression.